DuPont Company a permit for them to run their contaminated wastewater down through two farms here out into this stream of water. One hundred and 51 of these animals that's died on this farm up here since this stuff has been coming down through this water. But they want to try to keep everything hushed up, like it's some kind of big secret of some kind that they're dumping it in here. They won't tell us what it is. They don't want to talk to me because I'm just an old dumb farmer. I'm not supposed to know anything. But it's not going to be covered up because I'm going to bring it out in the open for people to see.
Of the new and unique white substance.
The result is the greatest advance in cookware.
DuPont Teflon. Here are two different types of fry pans. This non-stick finish for cookware never needs scouring.
Muffins don't stick to Teflon. Fudge cakes don't stick to Teflon. Even sticky buns don't stick to Teflon.
And I had made an arrangement for you guys to get your picture taken.
This one right here?
Mm-hmm.
I always tell her this picture. It just, I just look at this and it just.
It says, "We invaded the third buck. You were 6 years old. You went to Jeb Stuart Middle School in kindergarten, 86 yeah. and 87.
I don't know. I feel so bad for that kid.
This kid.
Yeah, not because of anything you, just because the times were hard. I knew you guys were working as hard as you could. And I'm wearing a velvet green shirt, you know? I just remember it was my first year of school that I actually went to school with kids. And I stood out.
Yep. That was when you were first born.
How long do they wait to take pictures?
I'm sure they wanted to get that one taken right away because
there was a chance that I might not make it.
That's what they said. When Bucky was born, I went into shock. He was born with a half of a nose, one nostril, a serrated eyelid, and a keyhole pupil where the iris and the retina is not connected. You could tell he was in distress because he couldn't breathe really well.
The ingredient in it is fluorine. You hear the word F in that, right? PFOA, PFOS, anything with the F in it is something you want to be very wary of.
These chemicals have these wondrous properties, non-stick, oil repellent, water repellent.
How do you recall C8 first coming to your attention?
First recollection I have of it is when the supplier of the chemical, the 3M company, provided DuPont with some information about rats that had been subjected to exposure to the chemical.
3M had some test data indicating potential birth defects here in the eyes of rat fetuses following exposure to C8. Right.
That's correct.
So you did see.
But certainly in the developed world, where all of these chemicals are widely used, every baby is born with at least some level of C8, of PFOS and PFOA in their blood. That's the essence of exposure, lifelong exposure. And it's involuntary. No one said, hey, you know, I'm good with a little Teflon chemical in my baby's blood. No one said that. They said, I love these pans. We think of these chemicals as associated with 3M and DuPont, but they also had sold them to other companies that manufactured consumer products, manufacturing products. It was used in airplanes and cars, on and on. The applications were endless.
Workers are now using Teflon to rust-proof the inside of the Statue of Liberty.
They found that these chemicals could bond paper products to make food wraps, greaseproof wraps, cookie bags. One of the largest companies had patents for making popcorn bags.
Thousands of facilities, including the furniture store down the street that sprayed a nonstick chemical on your couch to keep stains off. All of those places became environmental contamination sites.
And today, a product that you'll find Teflon is in clothing and things. Gore-Tex is the brand name. These are apparently...
And then you realize that companies in Asia and in Europe were starting to make these chemicals as well.
Tierte Teflon PTFE-Beschichtung aus?
This crisis had been growing for decades.
I think with a chemical that potentially is biopersistent, you pay particularly close attention to it.
Bioaccumulation, biopersistence, those are fancy words for it.
What do you mean by biopersistent?
When you die and they bury you, you're going to have it in your blood.
C8 seemed to have a long half-life in humans.
Sunlight doesn't break them down. Microbes don't break them down. Heat doesn't break them down. Nothing breaks them down.
They called this fluorine chemical the devil's piss. It was so potent.
Once it gets into your system, it remains in your blood.
My gut tells me the biopersistence issue will kill us because of an overwhelming public attitude that anything that is biopersistent is harmful.
And so naturally, these Teflon and Scotchgard chemicals permeated the living world.
Bath out of control. That's the best way of describing it.
After they made the Teflon, it had water that was discharged from it. My job was to pump it out back so it would go directly to the river.
As C8 was being used at that DuPont plant, 3M told DuPont that under no circumstances should you put it in waterways. It's right there in the document. Don't put this in the waterways. But at the end of the day, they start dumping so much C8 into the water that they, at one point, lose track of how much they've actually put out there.
DuPont wanted to figure out how far it had seeped beyond its plant. So a team of folks went out with some jugs, plastic jars, and went to general stores and went miles downriver to collect samples. They found that, in fact, the chemical had gone quite far from the plant.
Their own scientists, again and again, their own lawyers, in fact, told them, you know, we really should tell people about this because they're drinking it, they're bathing in it.
Who makes the final decision as to whether or not there is a risk that needs to be disclosed to the community?
Well, again, risk is relative.
I thought, well, boy, that's a strange attitude. I got a hold of the clean water people. I went to the wellhead people, Department of Health, and God, I mean, I got shut off on them. I told Darlene, I said, honey, something's not right here. So I called DuPont, talked to the head toxicologist for 45 minutes.
Pounding noise on the roof. It sounded like a hailstorm. It was a flock of birds. As they were flying over where the vent was, they just dropped out of the sky.
By 1984, the company knew that the material was going into the Ohio River, it was going up into the air, and weren't telling the community about it.
Did you work with a lot of other people that have been sick or died early?
One of my good friends, Carol Kaplinger, he had leukemia of the blood. He died.
How old was he?
He's only 50, 47, 50.
Anybody else?
Jim Broadwater. The last time I seen him, they were taking him to the Cleveland Clinic, and he died up there.
How old was he?
50. Pat Ankrum, she worked B shift, and she passed away. Joy Weaver, they had him on chemo. I knew him all my Teflon days.
Don Lutz,
Lana Frankow, Daryl Cronin, secretary.
How old was he?
30s. And I lost a good friend. He loved baseball. He was Cliff Spiker, Steve Bailey, Alona Carr, she passed away. Paul Radabaugh's gone. Glenn Pepper's gone. Cliff Smith's gone. Jim Huey, he had a tumor show up. A month later, he died.
Is there any doubt in your mind that all of these people were exposed to C8 based upon your personal observation?
To the best of my ability, I say they were all. And to see somebody you'd work with every day, my friends, die, that's hard. That was devastating.
Okay, but it says big announcement. Go ahead and read that next to the last paragraph. Right.
Big announcement, 3M, 2 days ago. It is going to stop making Scotch guard because it is too persistent in the environment and gets into our blood. They then told us they are going to stop making a related product that is an essential ingredient in the Teflon polymer, also is very persistent and also gets into blood, but so far no signs it has hurt anyone. If it does, we are really in the soup because essentially everyone is exposed one way or the other.
Came across this issue was May of 2000. And it was just a short little story that 3M had decided to replace the chemistry that was underneath Scotchgard with something else, and that this was going to cost them hundreds of millions of dollars in that year.
3M was presenting to the US EPA some information that had just come in, some rat studies with PFOS and the widespread presence of the chemical being found in the blood as well. And EPA was expressing concerns about that data.
3M and the EPA hammered out an agreement where they would voluntarily take PFOA and PFOS off the market.
At the time, the best producer of the perfluorochemicals was 3M. DuPont looked at that business, and I was there at the time, and they said, "Yahoo, the king is dead."
And in fact, within a few months, DuPont made a decision not only to continue using PFOA, but to actually begin manufacturing PFOA at its facility in North Carolina, correct?
I don't recall the exact timing or phasing, but you're correct. Within some period of time, we concluded to manufacture the product and to continue using the product.
The attorney who was working on the Tenon case at that time came across this announcement of 3M's decision, and that, in fact, is when he made the connection. DuPont had dumped a similar chemical in the water on Tenon's property.
I sent a letter to the US EPA on March 6th of 2001, summarizing what we were seeing in the internal documents, providing information to the agency to let them know, we think you ought to look into PFOA and investigate it.
Rob Bellott would fight DuPont to disclose documents that had anything relevant to this chemistry. As these documents came to his possession, he would send the most relevant ones directly to EPA.
It's horrible to believe that every day we get up, we're at the mercy of a corporation who might lie to us, who might poison us, who might create a product that's going to kill us for profit.
Issue which will decide future action is one of corporate image and corporate liability. Liability was further defined as the incremental liability from this point on if we do nothing, as we are already liable for the past 32 years of operation. See that?
Yes. And already admit we have been liable for 32 years. They had made a money decision.
On the neck of a position of total elimination. They have no incentive to take any other position. See that?
Yes.
Product group will take a position that the business cannot afford it.
We know that there was a discussion about, do we need to come up with something in our Teflon production that's not going to cause these problems? Coverage has been broad in print and network media. Significant disruptions in our markets and our consumers are very concerned. We need EPA to quickly, like first thing tomorrow, say the following.
Consumer products sold under the Teflon brand are safe. Further, to date, there are no human health effects known to be caused by PFOA. DuPont did, in fact, ask EPA to make those statements, correct?
That's correct.
So all of a sudden, the EPA said, oh, yeah, we'll do whatever you want us to do, which is complete scam, utter scam. Capture.
They're sharing documents. They're showing each other things before they happen.
Through the negative stories is the voice of EPA, the governmental agencies that should have been responsible, the EPA. Those people were captured by DuPont. It's called corporate capture.
You know, we've got a lot of cancer in this area, and then you wonder why.
This is not just in West Virginia and Ohio. It's being found in drinking water all over the country.
PFOAs have been turning up in drinking water in New York State, Vermont.
There are some new concerns today over the drinking water in Newcastle, Delaware.
The drinking water in portions of the Tennessee Valley.
This is something that affects everyone all over the country.
Should be more worried about people's lives.
And in every continent on the planet.
PFOA.
Bedrijf DuPont produceerde Teflon voor anti-aanbaklaar.
The planet is, the planet is, and DuPont's profit.
You have to realize the argument that DuPont said is, so what? It's in your blood. No! And my position would be, you have no right to pollute my blood.
Like, if I go out here and sprinkle arsenic around, and it gets in people's water, and they slowly get poisoned and they die, they'd arrest me and charge me for murder. They ought to go to jail.
$16 million? Really? This is a company at the time that was selling $25 billion worth of products every year. I'm not sure what the right fine would be for contaminating humanity, contaminating the living world, but I'm pretty sure it's not $16 million.
Was to participate in a gradual phase out of C8. 2015, nobody could make C8.
They say that we're not going to stop making Teflon. So should we find something besides C8 to make it with? GenX is what they're calling it.
When there's no safety standard, when there's no required set of tests to bring a chemical to market, you never know if getting rid of one chemical is going to result in bringing in a substitute that's just as bad or worse.
Once they started making GenX, DuPont initiated a rat study, and the results showed the same kind of tumors that we saw with PFOA.
Is being tested for a toxic substance called GenX. It turned up recently in the Cape Fear River.
GenX is the replacement chemical being used for Teflon production after DuPont was found to be using a previous toxic chemical.
DuPont did stop using C8, but they've just replaced one poison with another.
New owners, with startups with 200 years of experience.